早上我从台中开车下来，一直在回忆这个九年来在 NHI 跟大家共聚的日子，所以我第一句话要讲的是 It's nice to be home。 这里就是我的熟悉的卡利跟好朋友回家真好谢谢院长的邀请，给我这个 honor 来 deliver 今天这个 keynote。 各位院士，各位好朋友，各位朋友大家都好。我刚刚看到在这个 screen 看到我八年前我给了这个 lecture， 时间真是飞得真快很高兴今天又有这个缘分给大家来报告一下我们实验室的一些最近的研究成果。好，所以我还是以 用英文来讲。在座我知道国务院同事里头呢有很多是外籍的博士后，所以 I'm going to speak in English。 So I'm going to share with you some of our recent research in the tumor microenvironment。 Tumor microenvironment has become a subject of pursuit because in recent years we realized that it determines whether cancer cells will progress or will become dormant or become invasive。Breast cancer, as you most of you are aware, is the second most common cancer in the world, next to lung. Lung cancer is the top. It's most frequent cancer among women, and about 1.7 million new cases in 2012. And it's about 500,000 deaths every year. It's the fifth from the cancer overall.25% of cancer deaths. It's a very serious problem. Histologically, 75% of them are so-called invasive ductal carcinomas, invasive tumor. About 10% is called DCIS, ductal carcinoma in situ. And in, it's the first, as I say, first leading cancer, female cancer, and also in Taiwan as well. And it's a fourth mortality.Now with the development of the gene profiling, we are able to subtype the cancer according to the gene marker. And the Lumina A, Lumina B, HER2 positive and basalite, this includes triple negative, which is the most malignant type. And there are different markers.And mostly in the more benign subtype, the ER-positive hormone receptor-positive, so this can be treated with hormone. When they become hormone negative, they cannot be treated with hormone, and it has to be dependent on chemotherapy, target therapy. So this is just a brief look at it, how they fare out with different types of breast cancer.And they emphasize the basal type, including triple negative breast cancer, is the worst, the red line here, compared to Lumina A and B. And fortunately, in Taiwan, over 60% belong to the Lumina type. So, just to give another note about the triple negative breast cancer, constitutes about 10 to 15% of all breast cancer.And as I say, it's not hormone therapy or target therapy, and it's the worst prognosis among all subtype of breast cancer. For example, with the, compared to the non-triple negative has a 2.6 years of average median time for metastatic recurrence, compared to 5 years for the non-triple negative cancer, breast cancer. Okay, so I begin to tell you a little bit about microenvironment important in governing the cancer progression. Almost at every step, in all steps of tumor development, including the primary tumor, When they travel to the distant side, and when they arrive at the distant side and become colonized and progressing there, it's intimately interacting with the environmental factor, including cellular and non-cellular constituents, even in the circulation in the blood, and also interacting with the component in the blood, which govern and determine how they're going to be able to invade. And obviously, when they arrive at a distant organ, there are also all kinds of cell type and molecule around them, and they also determine whether they will become dormant or progressing there. So this is the a very important realization after half a century of study. I, among the first, very first one to discover the oncogene or SAR. At that time, we all believe oncogene everything. All you need is a mutation of oncogene and that cancer will develop. No, not so. It also depends on the surrounding component. So just to emphasize, these are blue ones, are the cancer cell, and all around them are the normal cell and immune cell. And now everyone know that immune checkpoint expression is very important in immune therapy, and non-cellular constituent molecules, they are important, interacting and determine how cancer cell is going to fare out in the process. So in the first part, I'm going to share with you a recent finding of a metabolic regulatory enzyme called transketolase. And this, as I will tell you, this is governing the glucose metabolism. And we found that it's able to regulate dynamic switch of glucose metabolism to control breast cancer metastasis via its substrate. It's called alpha-ketoglutarate. So, metabolic disorder is a risk factor for all kinds of diseases, including cancer, and various kinds of cancer. And in fact, inhibitor for metabolic enzyme has been developed as a therapeutic for cancer. For cancer cell, a prominent property is called Wobble effect. And so Otto Wobble in 1956 published a paper in Science called On the Origin of Cancer Cell. And basically it says that the growing tumor cell has a prominent characteristic of being able to maintain high rate of glycolysis for ATP, high molecular ATP energy molecule generation, despite of the oxygen availability. And this is by far the most prominent, one of the most prominent properties of cancer cell. And unfortunately, there's a very little exception, which is a so-called Wobble effect. So glucose metabolism is a very important characteristic of tumor cells. So in normal cell, differentiated cell, most of the glucose is channeled to the mitochondria to go through TCA cycle and oxidative phosphorylation. In very small amount goes through the so-called anaerobic glycolysis, which generates only a very small amount of ATP compared to the oxidative phosphorylation TCA cycle. However, in the tumor cell, because of a need of rapid need of high energy and also the substrate for nucleic acid synthesis, actually tumor cell channel most of glucose metabolism through glycolysis to generate lectin. Yeah. And only a small percent goes to mitochondria. Okay. So that's the difference. And also, cancer cells are more or less addicted to this glycolysis pathway for growth. So how does this happen? How does this happen? It turns out that there are a series of molecules, such as what I listed here, actually alter in the tumor cell. And this molecule are the regulator of glycolysis, including transcription factor and here, and also other enzyme that regulating glycolysis. So our aim is to identify the metabolic enzyme that are important regulating growth and metastasis of breast cancer cell, and to assess what if they can be exploited for clinical application. So Tutela, we use the immune competent syngeny marker 41 biopsy marker, and we grew tumor of different size from small to big, and then take the different size tumor and subject them to proteomic analysis. So then we analyze those proteins that are upregulated. Of course, there are many of them. I'm just single out this one, which we believe we have been focusing on, and then this is by your CMAS. We determine what it is, and it turned out to be transketolase. So among some upregulated and some downregulated, and they are all involved in regulating glucose metabolism. And then we decide to focus on this best study enzyme called transketolase, or TKT. So the enzyme we found turned out to be governing glycolysis, pentophosphate pathway, or TCA cycle, and less than amino acid metabolism site. So, as I said, TKT is the one that we decided to focus on, and TKT was known to be able to link between pentophosphate pathway and glycolysis, but it was not known for its role in regulating the glycolysis and TCA cycle. So this is the story that I'm going to tell you that we have found. So I'm going to first tell you the clinical significance of TKT, because before we focus on one particular molecule, we'd like to know what might be the significance and tell us. So this is the typical Kaplan-Meier plot showing that the higher expression of TKs is has a poor prognosis. In particular, in triple-negative breast cancer, this is the high expression, it's a low expression, and there's a big difference in the survival. And this is an Oncomine database. And again, here's compare another database. We can compare the TNBC and non-TNBC triple-negative. Look at the triple-negative is a high expression of TKT. And this is from our own sample, from local, and comparing normal tumor lymph node metastasis there from the same patient. And so you can see that the tumor and particular lymph node metastasis has a higher expression of TKT. So it's compared to the normal, the tumor has higher expression, and compared to the lymph node versus tumor, lymph node has higher expression of TKT. That's TKD is clinically significant in breast cancer, so we decided then we can go ahead to study. So then I'm going to show you some of the in vitro assay to explore how what the function of this enzyme. So it can regulate proliferation. So if we knock down TKT, then the proliferation goes down in lung, and this is now triple negative. These two are triple negative, and also the growth was inhibited by knocking down the TKT as taken out of the assay. And also, the cell arrested at G2M phase, and cumulative at G2M phase, not much effect in the G1, but GM2 phase is increased in the knockdown cell. It also inhibits migration of the cell. One of the properties for invasive cancer cell is a migratory ability, and showing that by knocking down TKT, it also reduced the migration ability of triple-negative breast cancer cell, and also inhibit invasion of triple-negative cell by knocking down TKT. Also, inhibit increased independent growth. This is an important property for the cancer cell people to survive during circulation and to actually reach the distant organ. So we assay for encourage independent growth ability, but found not done, also reduce the encourage independent growth current information ability. So then we turn to the in vivo assay, look for tumorigenesis. The first question we ask whether TKT can affect the targeting of the organ. So the two step, basically it's three steps. So first step for metastasis and tumor cell to leave the original site and get into the circulation. The second step is survive circulation. And then to find the right organ. for his home, new home.
So we ask whether or not PKT can affect that. So when we disinject the cells from the pelvis, then 30 minutes later, 24 hours later, we look for the cell in the lung.
The tumor cell in the lung.
So this shows that basically there's no difference. Okay, so this tells us PKT does not affect the cell able to reach the metastatic organ. However, if we then wait for longer for tumor cell at a distant organ, in this case lung, to develop, and we find that there's a dramatic difference upon knocking down the metastatic activity greatly reduced. And this is histological, it just shows that this is a knockdown cell. You've seen this is a normal lung histology, and this is a lot of tumor nodule in the control. Okay, so next thing I'm going to tell you that how this happened. Why TKT is able to affect cancer cell growth and metastativity? So we look for, since TKT is a transcriptase, it's regulated glucose metabolism, we look for a metabolite that might be affected by this enzyme. Here we show that, haven't mentioned that alpha-ketoglutarate is a product of TKT. You know, TKT with catalyte generating alpha-KG. So TKT is knocking this down, this goes up, goes up. And so we compare TKT knockdown here, and here compare adding alpha-KG here, and turn out it gives the same effect. So TKT knockdown, this goes down, it goes down, some goes up, and likewise here, although some are not as prominent, but the pattern is the same. In other words, knocking down KT, the phenotype mimics that of adding alpha-KG. So then we turn to alpha-KG. Alpha-KG is a simple metabolite, so alpha-ketoglutarate. So we just treat the cell with alpha-ketoglutarate, then it can inhibit this proliferation. It also affects invasion and migration. Then we again, important is to see how whether or not alpha-KG can be exploited in vivo as an inhibitor of tumor growth. So then we did is inject the tumor cell also topically and mammary fat pad, which is a breast cancer cell. Then 24 hours later, we started inject the alpha-KG intraperitoneally and continue with the course of the experiment, in this case, 3 months. So this is a result. So this is a primary tumor with some inhibited, the non-metastasis inhibited, and lymph node metastasis inhibited by just treating the mice with alpha-KG. This is another experiment, again showing the inhibition of primary tumor somewhat, and more significantly the non-metastasis. In this case, look at the lung. So then, we further dig in how molecularly this happened. How TKT regulate those metabolites? So it turns out it's through alpha-KG signaling pathway. And this is just a little bit background. Actually, alpha-KG is already known to enhance the hip proteal hydroxylase. And this result is stabilization of the HIF-1 alpha, which is already been shown. The other two players, succinate and human fumarate hydrolase, dehydrolase and hydrolase, they are so-called tumor suppressor because they will reduce amount of succinate and fumarate and reduce the TCA cycle and channel to the glycolysis, which cancer cell welcome. So higher succinate and fumarate are bad for the patient in that sense. However, all this prayer not known how they like breast cancer so far is not clear. So that we allow us a chance to study. Another prayer, HIF-1 alpha, is regulator, a very important enzyme for lactate dehydrogenase A. And this LDHA is a tumor promoting metastasis. Yeah. Just want to show that this is a prayer that's going to going to look at it. So again, here we compare TKT knockdown with alpha KG addition and look for all those players that I mentioned, and you can see that actually they're mimicking the same effect. What, for example, here by knocking down TKT, fumarate isolates increase, and same thing here, and by knocking down TKT, PSD2, and this actually regulates the hydroxylation of HIF-1 alpha and destabilize the HIF-1 alpha to increase, and we add in the alpha KG also increase. So they mimic the same effect by knocking down AKT, which promotes tumor growth, or adding alpha KG, which inhibits tumor growth. And so this the prayer behind their effect. So reduce AKT lead to alteration of metabolite in glycolysis and TCA cycle. And this all the metabolite in these two, some of the metabolite in these two cycle. And by knocking down AKT, we did reduce this, and increase. And so this, we do this to show this is why the glycolysis channel is switched to TCA cycle, because of the enzyme behind them, and as a result of substrate alteration. Therefore, the pool of substrate is less to go through that pathway, whether it's TCA cycle or glycolysis. So if you remember past previous PowerPoint, then alpha KG is the exact same effect as the TKT. So you would reduce this, increase this. And this is why they affect the glycolysis pathway and TCA cycle. So we turn to the typical assay, so-called Seahorse assay, is to look at the cellular acidic rate. This is representing glycolysis rate or oxygen consuming rate. This is representing oxidative phosphorylation of TCA cycle, and this is glycolysis. And this is a typical cycle using different inhibitor to look for the activity of glycolysis and also activity for ECA is glycolysis, OCA is oxidative phosphorylation, oxygen consuming rate. So you look for how high the peak here is within with different manipulation. So this is a typical assay. By doing that, we find by knocking down TKT, we find the glycolysis ECA rates reduce, but the OCA rates increase. So in other words, you shift the pathway of glycolysis to favor the TCA cycle. Now let's look at the alpha KG addition. It's exactly the same thing. By adding AKG to the cell, it would reduce the glycolysis and increase the TCA cycle's OCA alpha and reduce ECA. So that explains why through regulation of the metabolic enzyme, thus generate even pool of metabolite. The metabolite would not be able to fuel glycolysis or TCA cycle, depends on the our manipulation. And that explains why TKT knockdown or addition of alpha KG can affect the tumor growth, because we take away the favorite pathway glycolysis. So this is just a summary of what I told you. So TKT knocking down will increase alpha KG, will stimulate PSD2. PSD2 hydroxylate, cannot hydroxylate HIF-1 alpha, and HIF-1 alpha is degrading. So HIF-1 alpha degradation is one of the reasons that would block the cancer cell growth, angiogenesis among other things. And this alpha is not the only pathway, but we find this is one of the important pathways. And you can see here, this lactic dehydrogenase be able to promote metastasis, as mentioned earlier, but we destabilize HIF-1 alpha, so HIF-1 alpha reduced, so this is reduced, so this is inhibited. So that's our explanation. Now, given that, what can we exploit that for clinical inhibition? So TKT was a potential prognostic marker, this already I showed you earlier. Now we further show that TKT regulates triple negative breast cancer progression, this in the animal model and in vitro. So we ask whether or not we'll be able to exploit TKD inhibitor by combining, which is the oxybiamine, this is a TKD inhibitor, by combining with the current known drug for the treatment. And so just look at one, this is already known as an inhibitor, and this could induce cell apoptosis and suppress tumor cell growth in other system. And this can restore, this inhibitor can restore sensitivity in a imatinib resistant chronic CML, and this is already known. So, but however, in the supernatant cancer, in breast cancer, it is not known how it might be able to help. So we did this experiment by combining oxystiamine, which is a TKD inhibitor with docetaxel, which is the first line triple-negative breast cancer drug. And it just suffice to say that yes, by adding together, it does decrease, does enhance the killing effect in two cell-based acids. Both are triple-negative. Obviously, this is not enough. We have to look at it more. And so the future work, we would take this to combine drug treatment in animal model, and obviously eventually, hopefully, be to enter a clinical trial to see whether this indeed could benefit. And also, since our KG now show that we're able to inhibit breast cancer cell growth in animal model, we also like to try whether or not by combination with a drug in vivo, we be able as a single agent or in combination, whether or not be able to exploit it as therapeutic for breast cancer. So, okay, so the rest of time, I'd like to quickly go through the second part, also looking for the interaction between cancer cell and microenvironment, which I start to underscore in it. So we ask how metastasizing breast cancer cell establish niches in lymph node and lung to facilitate colonization and subsequent progression. Colonization is a must at the beginning because otherwise they would apoptose. And after colonization and microscopic colonies, then they would progress. But how? How do they able to survive in foreign territory? Who are the important players in this process? So, so I'd like to share with you that we have identified CD24, a small molecule, able to regulate angiogenesis of triple negative breast cancer, and it could be, potentially could be exploited as a therapeutic target. So how did we do that? So we went through in vivo selecting procedure to isolate metastatic cancer cell from lung and lymph node. We established a higher lung metastatic line called IV2, and we also isolated a lymph node tropical line we call LC. So this is just some of the cell shape of the IV2 and LC. This actually manifests very differently. The LC are more mesenchymal-like, where LC cells are more epithelial-like. And they all reflect their cell marker, which I don't have time to show, but it's interesting that they do this thing. So let's show again a different environment. They have to adapt different kind of morphology and marker expression in order to be able to survive and to prosper there. The LC, which is a lymph node tropic, now this sign also goes lung as well, but not that well as compared to the other non-tropic one. But this one goes to lymph node very efficiently. Okay. So it grows faster than the parental unselected line, and in the lymph node, and in lung too, it goes lung too, but it goes very well to the lymph node. So knowing that, then we ask who are the important players in LC9 that endow them the ability to metastasize to lymph node and also to lung. So we compare the multiple array analysis compared between 231 is a parental cell and LC is the lymphotropic, 231 is a parental and IV is the lung-tropic, and we select for the common gene appear in the, we subtract first these two, then we compare the remaining with invasive. And this is, I believe, this is one microRNA, and this is the gene. So by all this manipulation, we identify 190 genes that highly shell by which is up or down regulated, shell by the LC9 and invasive. And we went through the gene ontogeny analysis, made a call to analyze their role in different pathways. We narrowed down to 9, either whether it's a receptor or their soluble protein secreted. Why? Because this way allow us to develop potential therapeutic drug. Again, the intracellular or nuclear protein would be more difficult. So, just want to emphasize, we capitalize this LC infiltrated line for various expression marker. It turned out that has so MET property. In other words, they revert EET, they become more epithelial-like, so missing epithelial, mesenchymal epithelial transition. So they express crowding and they have less memantine and so on. But important things, they have elevated CD24, which is a small membrane anchor protein. So we ask how, this is the cell, the marker that expressed by this lymphonodal tropic breast cancer cell express CD24, CD44, and RDH1, alkyl dehydrogenase 1. So we ask how CD24 will be able to promote triple-negative cancer cell growth. First, again, we look at the clinical signaling can first. So it turned out that CD24 high expression actually has a poor prognosis, particularly in, this is different database, particularly in triple-negative, there is a quite a significant difference in HER2-positive, also such significant difference there. So we then, if we deplete CD24, we're able to affect the growth of multiple triple-negative cell line here, here, and here. So also in vivo, we knock down CD24, we would reduce the osteotropic growth of triple-negative tumor, shown here. This is two different microRNA knockdown, and this is a computation, the tumor weight here, and this is CD24 expression to make sure that CD24 was knocked down, indeed. And this is showing the in the non-metastasis, so showing that knockdown CD24, non-metastasis greater reduced. And now the lung, also other distant organ, including lymph node. This lung is very potent lymph node metastasis anyway, but also distant like bone, so also all reduced as can be that's with the Scott ex vivo IVIS analysis. That is, you take the mice, you open up, then use the IVIS analysis and quantify the signal. So this is some quantification. Axillary lymph node reduced, two different microRNA down, abdominal lymph node and lung reduced, bone reduced by knocking down CD24. And to show that why the tumor do not grow well, we analyze the angiogenesis and lymphoid angiogenesis. So breast cancer cell first go to armpit lymph node, and that's the first step, and from there it goes further up. So we look for lymphoid angiogenesis here, and angiogenesis obviously needed for tumor to progress beyond 0.5 centimeter. And this shows that it's not done, this is 2 microRNA, the angiogenesis, lymphoid angiogenesis is required. And we said, so I think at least this is probably one of the reasons the tumor doesn't grow well, and I don't think this is the only reason, but this at least the one of the reasons. Okay, so now why? So we further look into the underlying basis. We find that by depleting CD24, it would reduce ratio A and C, and this is a very important growth factor known to be for angiogenesis and lymphoangiogenesis. And this is shown here, two RNA, microRNA knockdown, regime A goes down, regime C goes down. and this is RNA and this is protein. So we like to think perhaps it's through regulation of the VEGF A and C. Now we like to know how CT1 will signal to regulate this endogenous factor. So to do that, we conduct what's called gene set enriched analysis, and then that is to look for our invasive cell which pathway are enriched, and actually single out two. One is MET, the other EGFR, and you can see this is the invasive cell and the two pathway enriched there. So with that, we are able to go ahead and analyze the CMET. This is CMET signaling. So first we look at the highly invasive cell, non-tropic, lymphonotropic, and we knock down the CD24, we look for which player are reduced. And phospho-MET, which is a receptor cytokine reduced, phospho-STAT3 reduced, SARP reduced, and I don't want to go through every single one of them, but it looks like it's affecting the MET signaling. Okay, and this is four different cell lines. This is related cell line, and this is independent cell line. They are triple negative, and they behave the same if we knock down CD24. And so then, what about EGF receptor signaling? And basically, it's the same thing. Okay. So we knock down CD24, phospho-EGFR will reduce, phospho-STAT3 reduce, SARP reduce, and so on. Of course, again, same thing in different cell lines, the behavior is the same. So it down-regulate the MET and EGFR signaling, which is very important for induced VEGF-A and VEGF-C and other growth-promoting signals as well. So we know that CD24 can go through EGFR and MET to promote them. So we knock down, reduce, we add, our expert promote them to promote breast cancer cell growth. But CD24 is also known to engage a extracellular molecule called P-selectin. And by engaging this, it has been shown to activate SARP. So we also look for this pathway, and indeed, these two cell lines, we add P-selectin, SAR is activated. 416 phosphorylation means activation, and 527 phosphorylation means inhibition. There's no change in 527, but the input is 416. However, if we knock down C24, then there's no activation of SAR. So it affects MET, EGFR, and P-selectin mediated pathway. So with that, then again, we tend to therapeutic application by injecting CD24 monoclonal antibody. This is a commercial one. I don't think it's the best, but we'll give it a try anyway. It's very expensive. So we inject the tumor cell orthotopically, then followed by injection of monoclonal antibody, and here's the result. In this case, it did not affect the primary tumor growth much, but it does affect the change the lymph. Let me see. Lymph node, the lung metastasis right here. So again, I could go back to literally how CD24 or other the receptor regulated by the MET be able to serve as a biological marker and biomarker for prognosis. Here we compare the CD4 expression and in the different combination, and it is clear that the CD24 high and the MET high has a poorest prognosis. This is from this particular database. And this is yet another database, assumption, C24 high, C24 low, is predict the poor prognosis. And this is the this is yet another this is data set. So this again, C24 high, MET low, C24 high, MET high, and obviously C24 high and MET high, so the poor prognosis. So these two combinations, and C24 and MET have not been used in the prognosis of triple negative of breast cancer. And we think, based on our finding, we suggest that this could be used in the future for prognosis in triple negative breast cancer. So to sum it up, CD24 regulates MET and EGFR to affect the region A and C, and to affect angiogenesis and angiogenesis. In addition, is through P-selectin, people ask a sub-division, which also could affect the various properties of cancer cells. So what's next? So we like to, again, see whether we be able to use CD24 as a therapeutic, and to do that, we collaborate with Sichuan, which is the Shengyao for here. We are now making monoclonal antibody, trying to see whether that could be used as inhibition of triple negative breast cancer growth and metastasis. So, I'd like to acknowledge my colleague, the TKT part, the first part, was done mostly by this postdoc, Zheng Jianwei. And the CD24 is done by a very capable this assistant, Zhang Shixuan. Actually, he is now a PhD student with Tsinghua University. So, and the rest of the group in the back.